First of all, good afternoon to all the all my seniors and my colleagues and all the people present for this lecture. I'm very sorry for being a late. There were some issues with my laptop and then with some internet. So today we're discussing about immunization in the immune. It is important to know this because the so what we'd like to learn or discuss today is basically all the vaccine and the schedule recommendations which exist for the immunocompromised children. So this is basically a special situation. So we'll study briefly about vaccination in transplant recipients. And we'd also discuss the timing of vaccination in people or in children who are taking immunosuppressive medications. And we'll also discuss in a little bit detail about what to give the vaccination, how to go about, what are the points to be kept in mind when giving vaccination to the HIV positive children. So immunocompromised children, they are in greater need for vaccines, definitely, because they are more susceptible to infections. Now, because of their immunodeficiency, they are definitely susceptible to infections. Now, because of their lower immunogenicity, the efficacy of the vaccine is might be lower, and there is a higher risk of adverse effects with the live vaccines in the children who are immunocompromised. So there is definitely a greater need for vaccines. There is a lower immunogenicity, which is an outcome or the desired outcome of the vaccine. And there is a higher risk of adverse effects whenever there is administration of a live vaccine. So all these things need to be kept in mind. And these are the points we need to keep in consideration when we are dealing with immunization in immunocompromised children. So there are some general principles for vaccination of the immunocompromised children. So all inactivated vaccines can be given, but immunogenicity and efficacy may be a little bit lower. That is basically because of the immune compromise of the immune damage of the inherent immunity of the child. Second thing, that in severe immunodeficiency, all the vaccines are contraindicated. We do not want any live vaccine to actually create an infection and create a problem for the children. In mild to moderate immunodeficiency, live vaccines may be given if the benefits outweigh the risks. And patients who have been administered live vaccine inadvertently prior to the diagnosis of immunodeficiency should be watched for vaccine-related sites. Ideally, antibody titer should be checked post-vaccination on a regular basis, and the booster doses may be administered if required if the adequate immunogenicity has not been achieved. Given if it, for example, hepatitis vaccine, and for major or contents, but in stocks in 3 the past, the immunized should not receive the transmissible vaccines such as oral polio vaccines. So the household contacts of the immunocompromised should not receive transmissible vaccines such as OPV, but can safely receive other non-transmissible live vaccines such as MMR and varicella. And all the household contacts should be fully immunized, including varicella and influenza, to reduce the risk of transmission to the immunocompromised. Some vaccines, including pneumococcal, varicella, and depending upon the degree of immunocompromise, hepatitis A and inactivated influenza vaccine should be given to all the immunocompromised children. So this is the basically in general the common or the common general considerations which we need to consider, need to keep in mind, that mostly the live vaccines are generally contraindicated when the immunosuppression is very high. The near contact should not receive vaccines which are likely to transmit the virus. So the common situations which we come across, first important one is the HIV infection. Second is the immunodeficiency diseases, corticosteroids or immunosuppressive therapy, and transplant recipients. So first we'll discuss about the HIV infection recommendations and the schedule. So the children infected with human HIV are vulnerable to severe, recurrent, or unusual infections by the vaccine-preventable pathogens. The efficacy and safety of the vaccine, they basically depend upon the degree of the immunodeficiency and the cluster of differentiation. Generally, the cluster of differentiation or the CD4 counts less than 200 cells per cubic millimeter is known to elicit minimal or no host response. So even if there is a better antibody response, the antibody response may wane at a faster rate than in a normal person. So the antibody may wane at a faster rate in an HIV infected person. The antiretroviral therapy can improve the immune response to vaccine, but not to a level of an uninfected subject. Live viral and bacterial vaccines pose an enhanced risk for uncontrolled replication of the vaccine strains. Vaccination is usually safe and effective early in infancy, before HIV infection causes severe immunosuppression, and the duration of protection may be compromised as there is impairment of memory response with immune attrition. In older HIV infected children and adults, the immune response to primary immunization may be less, but protective immunity vaccines received prior to the infection is usually maintained. However, immunity to measles, tetanus, and hepatitis B wanes faster than other antigens. So this is the Indian Academy of Pediatrics, World Health Organization, the American Academy of Pediatrics, the ACIP, and the Center for Disease and Control and Prevention. They all recommend all the live vaccines in asymptomatic HIV infected children except for OPV. In a symptomatic child, all live vaccines are forbidden or contraindicated, and MMR, measles, and varicella vaccine may be considered on an individual merit. Yellow fever vaccine is contraindicated in symptomatic, but can be given in asymptomatic and those at the risk of exposure. Killed vaccines in an HIV infected child, ideally post vaccination monitoring of the seroconversion needs to be done. We need to check the immunoglobulin levels or the IgE levels, and then on the basis of that decide. And in an HIV infected child, there is a multifold enhanced risk of diseases like tuberculosis, hepatitis A, as well as B, measles, influenza, varicella, pneumococcal, and meningococcal. So we need to keep this condition in mind and give the doses of the vaccines. So this is the IAP recommendation. IAP recommendation for the vaccination of an HIV positive child or an HIV infected child. So at birth, for an asymptomatic child at birth, the recommendation is to give the vaccine at birth for the BCG. OPV vaccine is not present. We need to give DTP vaccine, yes, as per the routine schedule at 6, 10, and 14 weeks, and 18 months and 5 years. Polio vaccines, we need to give injectable polio vaccines at 6, 10, 14 weeks, then 12 to 18 months and 5 years. And if indicated, IPV to the household context. If IPV is not affordable, then OPV should be given for a child. Measles, yes, at 9 months. And for an asymptomatic child, yes, at 9 months. And for a symptomatic child, if the CD count, CD plus 4 count is more than 15%, MMR again, yes, at 15 months and 5 years. And again, in an asymptomatic child, yes, if the CD4 count is more than 15%. Hepatitis B vaccine, again, it is to be given at 1, 0, and 6 months. 0, 1 and 6 months. And one important thing needs to be considered here is for an hepatitis B S positive mother, if the mother is HBsAg positive at birth, then there is an additional requirement of hepatitis B immunoglobulin along with the 4 or the 3 doses as mentioned. HIV vaccination, yes, as per the routine schedule. Pneumococcal vaccine, yes, as per the routine schedule at 6, 10, 14 weeks and at 12 to 25 months. And one dose of polysaccharide vaccine at 2 months after PCV and second dose 5 weeks after the first. Inactivated influenza vaccine, yes, as per the schedule, beginning at 6 months and revaccination every year. Insufficient data to recommend as per ACIP and in an asymptomatic child. So for an symptomatic child, controversial, but for the rotavirus, it can be safely given for an asymptomatic child. Hepatitis A vaccine, yes. And for an asymptomatic child, we need to check for the seroconversion and give the boosters whenever required. Next is the varicella vaccine. Varicella vaccine for an asymptomatic child, yes, 2 doses at 4 to 12 weeks interval, and use a single antigen vaccine. MMRV and HIV infected children have not been studied. And for an symptomatic child, yes, if the CD4 count is more than or equal to 15%, less than 5 years for more than or equal to 6 months, or CD count more than 200 per cubic meters for more than 6 months, and 2 doses at 4 to week apart. HPV vaccine, yes, for the females only, as per routine schedule for 3 doses at 0, 1 to 2 months and 6 months of age, 6 months, which is starting at 10 years of age. So this is in brief about the schedule for an HIV positive child who is asymptomatic, as well as for a child who is a symptomatic child. Next, we will discuss in short about the transplant recipients, the recommendations, and the schedule. So there are basically hematopoietic stem cell transplants and solid organ transplants. So the recipients of hematopoietic stem cell transplant are like unimmunized, as they have lost all the memory response during the marrow ablation. So vaccine requirements for they are like the unimmunized, as they have lost all the memory response during the marrow ablation. So such cases need special considerations. So the special consideration include the 3 doses of tetanus or diphtheria containing vaccine should be administered 6 months after the transplant. And for patients aged more than or equal to 7 years, a dose of Tdap vaccine may be administered followed by 2 doses of TD vaccine. 3 doses of IPV, HIV and hepatitis B vaccine has to be administered at 6 to 12 months after this transplant. If a post-vaccination hepatitis B surface antibody concentration of more than or equal to 10 mIU per ml is not attained, then the hepatitis B vaccine course can be repeated. 3 doses of pneumococcal conjugated vaccine should be administered to adults and children starting at 3 to 6 months after the hematopoietic stem cell transplant. And for patients with a chronic GVHD, a 4 dose of pneumococcal conjugate vaccine can be given at 12 months after the transplant. At 12 months after the transplant, a 1 dose of pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine should be given, provided the patient does not have a chronic graft versus host disease. 2 doses of meningococcal conjugated vaccine should be administered 6 to 12 months after the transplant if the risk of meningococcal disease is high. And 3 doses of HPV at 6 to 12 months after the HSCT for female patients aged 11 to 26 years may be considered. The live vaccine should not be administered to the hematopoietic stem cell transplant patients with active GVHD or ongoing immunosuppression. And MMR and varicella vaccine should be administered 24 months after the transplant if the recipient is presumed to be immunocompetent. One dose of influenza vaccine, injectable influenza vaccine, should be administered annually to persons aged more than 6 months, starting 6 months after the transplant, and at 4 months if there is a community outbreak of influenza. And for children aged 6 months to 8 years who are receiving influenza vaccine for the first time, two doses should be administered. And influenza vaccine is recommended annually, lifelong in a post-transplant recipient. So this is basically for an hematopoietic stem cell transplant. It is like all the vaccines are repeated, almost all the vaccines are repeated, and the time duration of starting is after 6 months of the completion of transplant, given the child is presumed to be immunocompetent and there is no chronic graft versus host disease. Now, the other important consideration is the solid organ transplants. The solid organ transplant, their need for the immunization in the SOTs or the solid organ transplant recipients can arise from three factors. One is the immunosuppressive activity of the underlying disease itself, the rejection of the graft which has been put inside, and the immunosuppressive therapy given after the transplantation. So the immunization can be given to candidates awaiting the transplantation. In general, basically, whenever there is a chronic disease, whenever there is some, for example, there a child needs to be going for a kidney transplant for a chronic renal failure, definitely the child would be immunocompromised, the child would be immunosuppressed. So the immunization needs to be given to all these babies, because the standard vaccine series should be given to the children awaiting SOTs, because already they are a little bit immunocompromised. And they should complete all the immunizations prior to transplant in accelerated schedules if needed. And vaccination with all the live vaccines should be completed at least 4 weeks prior to the transplant. The optimal time to begin vaccine administration after the transplant for a solid organ transplant is not defined. And immunosuppressive therapy is most often intense during the first couple of months and might influence the effect of the vaccination. So in the post-transplant period, all live vaccines are contraindicated, and the patients where immunization has not been completed prior to the transplant, vaccination with inactivated vaccines can recommend or recommence 6 months after the transplant when immunosuppression has been lowered. So this is in brief about immunization whenever a child undergoes a transplant in the form of the hematopoietic stem cell transplant or a solid organ transplant. The recommendation and the schedule for immunodeficiency disorders we'll discuss in short for the immunodeficiency disorders. In the congenital immunodeficiency, there would be B cell immunodeficiency, there would be T cell immunodeficiency, then complement deficiencies and phagocyte defects or chronic granulomatosis. So for an B cell immunodeficiency, in patients with a severe B cell immunodeficiency, like X-linked A gamma globulinemia, all the live vaccines, including live bacterial, oral typhoid, or live viral, like OPV, MMR, measles, varicella, and live attenuated influenza vaccine, these all are contraindicated and they need not to be given. Inactivated vaccines can be given. Measles and varicella vaccines may be given, but may be ineffective due to concomitant immunoglobulin therapy. All inactivated vaccines may be given, but are ineffective. Pneumococcal and Hib are risk specific, recommended in such children. And in less severe B-cell deficiencies, such as IgA and Ig surplus deficiency, only OPV is contraindicated. For T-cell immunodeficiencies, in patients with severe T-cell immunodeficiencies, all the live vaccines are contraindicated and all the inactivated vaccines are ineffective. Risk-specific recommended vaccine is pneumococcal and Hib, but the response is variable. Patients who have received live vaccines, especially BCG prior to the diagnosis, face an increased risk of complications, including disseminated BCG diseases. And for patients with combined immunodeficiencies, such as DiGeorge syndrome, Wiskott-Aldrich syndrome, ataxia telangiectasia, inactivated vaccines may be given, but live vaccines are contraindicated. in patients with phagocyte defects such as chronic granulomatous diseases, only live bacterial vaccines are contraindicated and other vaccines may be safely and effectively given. And if in phagocyte defects that are undefined or associated with T cell and natural killer cell dysfunction, such as like Chidiak-Higashi syndrome, leukocyte adhesion deficiency, myeloperoxidase deficiency, all live bacterial and viral vaccines are contraindicated, but all inactivated vaccines are safe and likely to be effective. And pneumococcal vaccine in such cases is specifically recommended. So this in very short about the vaccines and the recommendations for the children who are immunocompromised or congenital immunocompromised, and for children who are going immunosuppressive therapy in the form of steroids or in the form of other drugs which causes immunosuppression. So for children receiving oral corticosteroids in high doses, for example prednisone at 2 mg per kg per day or 4 dose weighing more than 10 kg, 20 mg per day or its equivalent, for more than 2 weeks should not receive any live virus vaccines until the steroids have been discontinued for at least a period of 1 month. Killed vaccines are safe but may be less efficacious, and children or a lesser dose of steroid or those on inhaled or topical therapy may be safely and effectively given their age appropriate administered corticosteroids in children who have a disease that in itself is considered to suppress the immune response. The same holds good for those who are receiving immunosuppressant medications other than corticosteroids. So these children should not receive live virus vaccines during therapy except in special circumstances. So whenever the active immunosuppression is going on or an active immunosuppressive therapy is going on at a higher dose, live vaccines are generally not indicated or contraindicated in such circumstances. And these children should receive live vaccines only in special circumstances. This is it. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Neeraj. Yes, you haven't talked about those patients who are on cancer chemotherapy and how will you manage those patients once they finish their chemotherapy?
Yes, ma'am. For the patients who are on cancer or chemotherapy, they are divided into the catch-up vaccines and those who have completed the primary schedule. That I have missed, I guess, in the talk.
Yes, that is very important.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
It is something which is more commonly faced than the transplants, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Would you like to say something?
Ma'am, for the specific, there are some specific recommendations for children with cancer. The live vaccines are contraindicated during and for 6 months after the end of chemotherapy. And non-live vaccines are also best given after 6 months from the end of treatment for durable immunity. Annual inactivated influenza vaccine is the only vaccine recommended for all the children during chemotherapy. Uh-huh. And hepatitis B is recommended only for previously unimmunized children. And the catch-up vaccine needs to be done for the IPV vaccines, for the DPT vaccine, for the HPV vaccines.
Yeah, so how many doses?
Ma'am, previously unimmunized child, if the child is less than 7 years of age, then 3 doses at 0, 1, 6 months. Mm-hmm. And TDAP first dose followed by TD second and third dose. And who had completed the primary schedule, we'd like to give a single booster dose TDAP or DTWP less than 7 years of age, and TDAP if more than 7 years of age. For the injectable polio vaccine, if the child is not previously immunized, we'd like to give 2 doses of IPV 2 months apart, and the third dose 6 months after the second dose. Completed immunization, we'd like to give a single booster dose of IPV. And if the child had previously received OPV, we'd like to give two doses of IPV 1 month apart. And okay. for HBV, for a previously unimmunized child, we'd like to give three doses at 0, 1, and 6 months. And for the child who had completed the primary series, we'd like to give the single booster dose. For the HIB vaccine, in the previously immunized child, from 6 to 12 months, we'd like to give two doses, which are 6 weeks apart, followed by a booster at 12 months. For 12 to 15 months, one dose, and then one booster at 18. And again, for 15 to 60 months, we'd like to just give one dose. And when the child had completed the primary dose, we'd like to just give one single booster dose. Again, for the pneumococcal vaccine, for if the child is less than 1 year, then we'd like to give two doses of PCV at 4 to 8 weeks interval, followed by a booster dose between 12 and 15 months. Again, at 1 to 2 years, two doses of PCV 8 weeks apart, and for 2 to 5, single dose of PCV. And if the child had completed the series, we'd like to give one single dose of PCV, and the pneumococcal polysaccharide we'd not like to give. And then the hepatitis A virus, two doses again for an immunized child, for a non-immunized child, and the child had completed the primary immunization and went for the cancer therapy, then we'd like to give one single booster dose of hepatitis A virus. For the typhoid vaccine, if the age is more than 2 years, the single dose of VI polysaccharide vaccine. And alternatively, if the age is more than 9 months, then two doses of typhoid conjugate vaccines 2 years apart. And a single booster dose of the polysaccharide vaccine, and then every 3 years thereafter. And if the child had completed the with the primary series with the typhoid conjugate, then post the chemotherapy, we'd like to give one typhoid conjugate booster. And human papillomavirus, two doses in a previously immunized child, again for 9 to 14 years, two doses of the vaccine 6 months apart. For more than 14 years, three doses at 0, 1, 6 months, or 2 to 6 months in the females. And BCG, we'll give a single dose of BCG in a previously unimmunized child. And if the child had come, given the vaccination was already given, then it is not be required. For MMR,
so basically, for what age would you like to give?
Up to 5 years, ma'am.
Yeah, you have to specify that.
Yes, the upper age limit would be 5 years, and single dose BCG in previously immunized child, and if the primary schedule has been completed, then again no requirement. Then for the MMR vaccines, in a previously unimmunized child, two doses at least 1 to 3 months apart. And the children who had already completed the primary series, just a single dose of MMR vaccine. And for varicella, in the previously unimmunized child who is less than 13, two doses of vaccine more than 3 months apart. And more than 13 years, two doses of vaccine more than 1 month apart. And if a previously the entire doses has been completed, we'd like to give just one single booster dose of varicella. The rotavirus, the recommendation, the upper age limit of vaccination is 8 months. So generally it is not required.
Probably sometimes that will not come into this scenario. Yes. So what is important in this in these pediatric cancer patients is that, if you want to make it more simplified, so in case the patient is unimmunized,
yes, then
you'll have to like do the schedule as in the normal child.
Yes, ma'am.
Like you'll have to do a three-dose schedule for the DPT, IPV, HIP,
yes,
and pneumococcal vaccine.
Yes, ma'am.
And for the hepatitis A virus, you have to specify that it has to be a killed vaccine, not the live attenuated.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Yes, and similarly, for the HPV, it will be in the combined vaccination. So usually when the cancer chemotherapy patients come back to us, yes, so we'll be using the combined vaccination, the hexavalent ones.
Yes.
So that is more easier to remember. Okay.
Yes.
But
yes,
in case the child is more, you know, it has already completed the primary immunization, and say it's a 7 or 8 year old child of ALL comes to you, then it is only a single booster dose, which is started 6 months after the stoppage of the chemotherapy. And very importantly, you have said that the flu vaccine is the only vaccine which is recommended in all groups, even during the course of therapy.
Yes.
Then for the typhoid vaccine, I'd just like to correct you here that we no longer recommend the polysaccharide one. We are only going to give the conjugate one, okay? Because that is also what has been recommended by WHO. Yes. So there is no role of the polysaccharide. We should stop talking about the polysaccharide now and talk only of a single dose typhoid vaccine 6 months after stopping chemotherapy for those who have been previously immunized as well as those who have not been immunized. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Definitely.
And in general, you have to remember that all live vaccines like MMR and chickenpox are to be given 2 years after the completion of the chemotherapy or the stem cell transplant, because then we expect that, you know, that immune response will be better and they will not get the infection.
Yeah.
If there are any questions from the other people who are listening, then I think Neeraj can reply.
I think Dr. Sri Chandu has a question.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Actually, I have one patient who has undergone liver transplantation for cholestasis. Actually, now the child is 2 years old. And the child is on prednisolone, oral prednisolone, 1 mg per day. And the child weight is 10 kgs, ma'am. Should we take the child as immunocompromised or immunocompetent child?
1 mg per kg, so 10 kg, 10 milligram.
No, 1 mg per day. Now the child is getting 1 mg per day prednisolone.
1
ml per day.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. 1 ml per day.
So, Neeraj, you want to reply that?
We can consider the child to be immunocompetent. And
so this child,
but the child.
This child now is on very, very low doses or maintenance doses of the steroid. So, he is like an immunocompetent individual and he should be given the vaccination as per the schedule for the immunocompetent.
Can we give live vaccines also for this child, ma'am?
Yes, we can give.
Okay, thank
you. So, already how many years post-transplant?
Actually, at 9 months of age, he had transplantation. Okay. Now, the child is 2.5 years old.
Yeah, so we can give the
live. Almost 18 to 19 months. Actually, for past 2 months, he is coming to me. I have started with Hexaxim for this child.
Yes, you can give. You can complete for the rotavirus and the OPV. You can give the IPV. You can give the other vaccines and as well as the
live vaccines also. We can
live attenuated viral vaccines. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody has any other questions?
I think we'll close the session now, ma'am.
Yes. I think it was a good discussion, but Neeraj, we missed out a very important part of the discussion. But thank you for your answers.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Neeraj.
Thank you.